Thank you for all the tributes. They were all so wonderful. And again, it's an honor and privilege for me to be here, to be able to walk alongside Jamal's family. I had the privilege of getting to know Jamal at Eagle Brook over the past couple of years. He was volunteering and serving at our campus like he was so many other places. What's been amazing for me is getting to know Jamal through his friends and through his family. And one thing you may have already noticed is that a family, if you saw it when we came in, they were all wearing Nikes. Luke talked about it before, the obsession and love that Jamal had for Nikes. So to honor him, we all have them on, and come on now, not a bad look for a pastor, right? So to honor Jamal, yes, thank you. So all the tributes, all the things that have been shared about Jamal today, they have a foundation to them. There was a spring of life that flowed from Jamal. And it came from his faith. It came from his personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Tori, you told me that every day Jamal would start his day in the shower praying to God. The first time he'd go, it said, "What are you doing?" But Jamal would pray every day in the shower, and he would end his time by writing a message to God on the steamed glass. He would pause, he would pray, and he would wipe it off. And that's how he started his day, with his Heavenly Father. Tori, you've been comforted. Boy, God is showing up in your life in a very difficult week that you've just gone through. I told Tori I like to refer to these as God signs. God is saying, "I'm here. I'm here to comfort you. I'm here to guide you and your family, Tori, and to love you." Tori shared a very personal story with me. She said that on Jamal's last night at home, she came home from a very long shift herself at work and was exhausted. As she came into her home, Jamal was cooking. He hadn't cooked in years because he's a terrible cook. He had cooked the kids' favorite meal, spaghetti, and it was wonderful. The family together spent the evening on the couch watching a movie together, and Mason, or Maymay, she fell asleep, and Jamal carried her up to her bed, tucked her in, and every one of the children in. What a loving memory for these children to remember their father the last time they saw their dad. That's a God sign. And now, Jamal's home with his loving Heavenly Father, completely whole, mind and body. He's been completely renewed because he is in the presence of Jesus. So at the beginning of the service today, I said we ask a lot of why questions, and they hardly ever get answered. And so I want you to ask a couple of questions that begin with what. First of all, what should I learn from this? Well, I believe we need to lean into family and we need to lean into friends. This is from John 13, 34 and 35. It says, "So now I'm giving you a new commandment. Love each other just as I have loved you. You should love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples." To get through grief, to understand this incredible loss, we need to lean into each other. I love what it says in Colossians 3, 12 through 15. It says, since God chose you to be holy people he loves, he must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, with kindness and humility and gentleness and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone that offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you and you must forgive others. Above all else, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Jesus Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and to always be thankful. So lean in, love each other, affirm each other, forgive each other on a daily basis. Let's not wait till someone passes to tell each other how much we love them, to affirm them in our lives for the wonderful things that they've done. Lean into each other. Second question. What's God trying to show me in all this? What's God doing with my heart? Here you need to lean into God and you lean into Jesus. Tori, I want you to know how proud I am for the way that you've been leaning into God in a very difficult week. And to Janet, to you too, for how you've been showing the love of Jesus. Thank you for leaning in. I really believe that God pursues us, and he wants a personal relationship with each and every one of us. He wants to bring comfort into our lives. But remember, life is, it's very temporary. In 2 Corinthians 4, 16 through 18, it says, that is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. Life is temporary, like was so evident in Jamal's passing. We need to be ready. Jamal was ready. John 14, these verses. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There's more than enough room in my Father's home. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. When everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me wherever I am. And you know the way to where I am going. But then Thomas, he says, no, we don't know where you're going, Lord. We have no idea where you're going. So how do we know the way? And Jesus told them, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So when we lean into Jesus, he has a gift for you. He gave his life for us. He died on the cross so that we might be forgiven of our sins. Jesus has a gift that can save your life. What's important is that all of us have a choice. You can lean into God or you can turn away. I've watched many families and people through the years that have had to deal with tragedy and very difficult things in their lives. And I've watched things go both ways. For the ones that turned away from God and did not look to Jesus, they faced more difficulties. There was more pain, there was more loss, there was more void in their lives. The ones that leaned into God, into Jesus, have experienced comfort. Their families have gotten closer. Relationships have been restored, and there's been a healing. As was read by Aunt Dee Dee earlier, Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. Jesus was Jamal's shepherd. Jesus was the reason Jamal was such a loving servant. Jesus was the reason he was fearless. Because he knew his hope was in his shepherd, Jesus. Jamal had responded to Jesus at a young age and followed him with his life. Jesus called Jamal's name. He calls every one of our names. I love what Jesus says in Matthew 11, 28 through 30. And this is taken from the Message. And Jesus says to all of us, are you tired? Are you worn out? Burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me. Work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Jesus calls us by name. I want to give all of you an opportunity to respond to Jesus. In a difficult time like this, I believe God moves. I believe he tugs on our hearts. That little voice that you might be hearing, that's the voice of the shepherd Jesus. He's calling each and every one of us by name. He's saying, come, come follow me. I will give you rest. This is your opportunity. I'd like to pause right now. To bow your heads and respond. And it's simple. It's just calling out to Jesus. It's saying, Jesus, be the leader of my life. Forgive me of my sins. I want you in my life. You're my Savior.